I'm going to talk about mechanics in plants, and actually, so I'm not going to talk too much about evolution, but when you think about it, mechanical forces is probably the thing that is the most conserved during evolution, because it was there even before molecules, I would say. So, but anyway, I'm not going to talk about too much about evolution, more like, well, you'll see, I'm going to talk about mechanics. So why do we look at mechanics when we're interested in development? So here is some slides just to introduce this question. So you've all heard about positional information, like a morphogen, deriving signals for gene expression, or like positional information with morphogens. So we can see that in Drosophila, in animals in general. This is also true in plants. So this is, for instance, the shoot apical meristem. So that's the apex, or the tip of a stem, of an inflorescence, actually. So all these are little flowers, very young flowers. And when we look at an hormone, which is called auxin, that's a famous plant hormone, we see peaks of expression. Like this GFP are marking the activity of this auxin. And you see that when you have a peak, you have a little flower that is going to emerge. So there's also positional information in plants, which is very well conserved in all systems. So what can we do with this type of information when we do development? So of course, we have a lot of molecular tools, so we can look at the, so this is the auxin, by the way, it looks a little bit like a tryptophan. So this hormone can, is going through a transduction pathway, so we can look at all the interactions between the factors. We can integrate this in the general regulatory network. But actually, this is not enough to understand morphogenesis and development. And this is a very, very simple assessment. What you are looking at here, the molecular input, if you want, or the molecular network, is something that is chemical and that we understand well at the single cell level. This, the shape, is a geometric output, and it's, in our case, multicellular. You see that these are two very different things. Chemical, single cell, multicellular, geometric. So how can we reconcile this? How can we go beyond distant correlation? So if you want, there is a big black box here that we cannot really resolve. So how can we do this? And this is where the magic of mechanics is playing its role. We have to introduce mechanics to make the connection. The genes and the proteins are going to affect the mechanical properties of the cell. These mechanical properties are going to change the shape of the cells. And when you change the shape of the cell, you change the shape of the tissue, right? So this is through mechanics that you can code the activity of genes into a structure. And what's in this, I put here an input and an output, but of course, this is completely untrue because the shape itself can be an input for the gene network. There are multiple feedback in all this, right? So you can decide that actually the shape is controlling everything and that this is the output, whatever the fluctuation you see in the molecular network, for instance. So this is important, I think. And how do we do this in practice? So we use a lot of quantitative imaging, and this is the only way you can code gene activity into mechanical output, is that you have to quantify the effect on the geometry of the cells, but also on the mechanics of the cell. With all this quantitative imaging on the real data, you can derive hypotheses at the single cell level. So in each cell, you can put an hypothesis. And this hypothesis, you can transpose it into an algorithm. So now each cell in silico is expressing this algorithm, which is a rule. You can put that in a multicellular model in which each cell is expressing this rule. And then you can compare what's happening in the model to the reality. And if there's a good match between the output of the model and the shape, you can say that the rule that you propose at the single cell level is plausible. Doesn't mean it's the rule, it's true, it just means it's plausible. It means that this is one possible explanation to link this gene network to this shape. Right? Is that clear? Yep. Okay. And with this, we can do the link a little bit. We get closer to causality, if you want, because now we have a little bit, put a little bit of light in the black box through this process. Okay, so before I start, really, I want to go through a few definitions just to make sure that we are all on the same page on the words I'm going to talk about or mention in my talk. So the first one is complex system. We've talked about complex system during this entire time, but I think it's important to have this really like written once for good. So a complex system is a set of entities that interact according to simple local rules. So typically you can show it like this with little interactions between elements. So that's this ensemble of interactions that is making a complex system. And it's well suited to describe structure without a clear leader, right? So it's really only the interactions between the elements that count for this complex system. So I just want, so that's clear for everyone, this definition, yep. But I'm going to go a little bit more to really make it crystal clear. We're going to do a little experiment all together, just to, so that you have an emotional interaction with the notion of complex system. So actually, I'm not going to do it, you're going to do it. So I'm going to, so you can drop your pen, and I'm going to ask you to upload, but you clap, you have to clap synchronously. Thank you. Okay, so you've generated a complex system. You see what I mean here. I said you have to upload synchronously, but I did not tell you at which frequency, and I didn't ask you for the pitch, I didn't ask you for the magnitude, the intensity. So all this is emerging from the local interactions you had with your neighbors. So you've created a complex system here. So just to make it really, really crystal clear, complex is not complicated. That's two different notions. So a watch, for instance, or a clock is complicated because there is one person who designed it, made all the interactions between all these elements. It's really carefully designed, but this is not emerging. There's a lot of interactions, but it's not emerging. It's the result is really like one person decided. Whereas an ant farm, which is this, so this, for instance, they just put like some resin in a, you know, an ant farm, and then you see this beautiful architecture underground. All this structure here, this complex architecture, there is no architect in an ant farm, right? So the queen is not the architect. It's the interactions between the ants, see that image? It's the interactions between the ants, it's the conversation between the ants that is making the architecture. So the architecture is the emerging properties of the interactions between the ants. And so that's a complex system. And of course, living organism, interactions between individual cells, that's a complex system. Okay, so that's, I think that's clear enough. I have a few more, just a last slide on complex systems. So this is just some, why do we use the notion of complex system in biology? So that's what we call systems biology. And so it's the discipline in biology that use complex system theory. It's to address many, many questions, among which these ones that are much more difficult to address without the theory of complex systems. So here, the use of a huge data set. So even though you can do it without complex system, but often we see systems biology using a huge data set because, of course, when you have a lot of interactions, then you can extract some more meaningful meaning with this theory. We also realize that not only if you have A induces B or something like this, and that can be interesting, but actually what's sometimes more interesting is the topology of the network. So at a larger scale, it actually sometimes has a more regulatory work, role than the local regulations. For instance, if you have a knot where all the elements are interacting with one protein, then you know that this one is going to be super important for the regulation of the network. It's also used a lot to look at the stochasticity, so we've been talking about this several times. So in my work, I'm mostly using actually these three ones, so it's used a lot to understand multi-scale properties, so, which is important in development, right? So if you start from a molecule, at the end, you have a multicellular organism. This is definitely a multi-scale, and so modeling is, computational modeling with systems biology is very useful for this. If you want to look at feedback also, it's really useful to use complex systems because it's very counterintuitive and some of the emerging properties are deriving from this counterintuitive feedbacks. And the last thing, since I'm interested in the mechanics, mechanical forces in contrast to hormones, for instance, are invisible. So the only way you can see mechanical forces is actually if you compute them. So you can show an arrow or something on a computer, but you will never see the force, right? Not a Jedi, so I don't see the force as well. Okay, so that's for a complex system. So I'm also going to talk about tension and compression, so I think that's pretty simple. So when you have tension, you pull, right? So the length is going to increase, and when you compress, the length is going to decrease. That's simple enough. So now we talk about mechanical force, but if you read papers on mechanics, there's also the notion of mechanical stress. And actually, I'm mainly going to talk about mechanical stress. And so why do we distinguish mechanical force and mechanical stress? This is a very, very simple reason. Mechanical stress is a normalized mechanical force. When you have a force, that is, let's say here it's tension pulling on this cylinder, if the area, the section here, is larger here than here, you see that the forces, I mean, the material here is going to experience more elongation, for instance. It's going to be more elongated if we have the same force here, just because there is less material to resist. Right? So to account for this, to really be close to the material properties, stress, so it's often noted sigma, is a force divided by the area. And that way, you normalize the force with the area, the section. Of course, it's the area of the surface that is normal to the force, always. Okay, so that's just a small point, but an important one. I mean, this is not too important for my talk, but since I'm going to talk about mechanical stress, this is the definition. I'm also going to talk about stiffness or rigidity, if you want. So that's qualifies this. It's actually easy to see on a spring. You probably all know Hooke's law. F equals minus kx, right? So this is the force, x is the deformation here, yeah? And k is the stiffness. So if you have something more stiff, you're going to elongate less, right? So it's really the rigidity of a material. So in this case, it's in 1D, which is quite simple. But if you take the generalized Hooke's law, this is for a 3D material, then you have to use stress in this case because you need to account for the surface area again. And so what you see here is this law here, sigma equals E epsilon. So sigma is mechanical stress, epsilon is the strain, so the deformation, and E is the stiffness, or the elastic modulus, also called the Young's modulus. And you see that it's really homologous to Hooke's law, a force equals stiffness time deformation. Here, mechanical stress equals stiffness through and strain. So it's really the really homologous equations, you know. But that's the way you relate stress and strain, strain being deformation. Okay. So these are some examples. So you see that, actually, maybe I can show it here. So sigma is force divided by a surface, so it's a quantity of a pressure, right? Newton per square meter. Epsilon, actually, I'm going to define it later, but it's dimensionless. So E, the stiffness, is measured in Pascal, like a pressure. And so this is what you get. So you have different examples. So maybe I can point at different things here. So diamond, for instance, of course, you know, it's really, really stiff. You see the number here, it's in megapascal. So rubber, for instance, is 7 megapascal. You can see also that cellulose is pretty stiff, 25 megapascal. And there are different behaviors, of course, but I'm not going to go into these details. And the strain, so sorry, I should probably have mentioned that earlier. So the strain, it's a dimensionless ratio, if you want. So it's also a normalized deformation, if you want. So it's L minus L0, oops, sorry, I should have done that. L minus L0 divided by L0. That's the most common way to measure strain. There are other ways. Huh? You can also do just the division between L and L0, but usually this is the most common one. You can do it in 1D, in length, but you can also do it in area, in volume, as well. And with this, you can compute a number of things, which are, for instance, the maximal strain rate. So this would be like in this direction, it elongates more, and the minimal strain rate. And this also is giving you an opportunity to measure the growth direction, the maximal growth direction, if you want, or the strain direction, already switching to a cell. So if the principal strain rates are the same in both directions, the strain is going to be isotropic. It's going to be the same in all directions. And if there is one that is maximal and one minimal, so the two are different, then it's going to be anisotropic. It's going to be one dominant direction. Okay. So these are really basic things, but just to make sure that we are all on the same page. Okay, so now I'm going to go more into the biology. I've been talking about strain, which is a more generalized question. It's just a deformation. But actually, for us, for today at least, we can consider that strain and growth are pretty much the same thing. Because growth is an irreversible increase in volume. That's really the definition. The minimal definition of growth is this. And I'm sure this is going to shock a number of animal people here, because you would probably say that growth, for the biologists, is more cell proliferation, right? Increase in number of cells, for instance. Actually, when you think about it, when you add more cells, you don't necessarily add more volume, right? You can compartment, you can have a lot more division and have exactly the same volume. And there is no growth in this case. But usually it's true that in animals, so this is one animal, for instance, so you go through this cell proliferation and there is an increase in size that is correlating well with the number of cell divisions. In plants, it's a little bit different. So the cells are also dividing. They can go through mitosis, but at some point, they stop dividing, at least for a while. It's a bit reversible, but usually they stop dividing, and then they only expand, right? And that's why usually the plant cells are much bigger than the animal cells. But you shouldn't think that they stop cycling, because actually what they do, they go through endoreduplication. So they keep on cycling, they just skip the M phase, the mitosis, right? So they go through G1, S, they duplicate their DNA, G2, and then up straight to G1. So they just have a nucleus that gets bigger and bigger. And then they have a cell that gets bigger and bigger, but they still cycle. So even though the plants and animals look quite different at the cell level, they both cycle. That's just what I want to say. And in the end, it's the volume increase that is really showing growth. Okay. Yep. The endoreduplication. So what happens? So this is a classical cell cycle, right? G1, S, G2, mitosis. And under duplication, you don't go through M. So if you want, it's as if you add only G1S, 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 or G1S, G2, G1S, G2. You go like this, but you don't divide. So you just have a nucleus that is duplicating its DNA, stays like this for a while, and then duplicates its DNA, stays like this for a while, duplicates its DNA, so it just gets bigger and bigger. And so in plant cells, you usually have huge nuclei. That are like 1024C. In all plants, or in most plants, I shouldn't say all plants, there's no 100% in biology, but in most plants, that's okay. So if you take any cell, if you harvest a plant somewhere, usually it's going to be a polyploid in a way, but through endoreduplication. Each time you see a giant cell or a big cell in plant, usually it has gone through endoreduplication. Okay, so a few more information to just so that I just want to make sure that you know what a plant cell is, because I'm going to talk a lot about plants. So this is a short drawing to show an animal cell and a plant cell. So I put the plant cell a little bit bigger, because usually plant cells are a bit bigger for what I said earlier. So one thing that you see in animal cell is an extracellular matrix. The plant cells also have an extracellular matrix. But this extracellular matrix is made of, many components. One of them that is really important is cellulose. As I showed you earlier, it's very, very stiff compared to animals. Another difference is that in animal cells, there are small vacuoles, whereas in plant cells, there are huge vacuoles. Okay, that's clear to you. And the last thing is the cytoskeleton. So plants have a cytoskeleton. The only thing they don't have is intermediate filaments. So there are three classes, right? So it's macrotubule, actin, and intermediate filaments. So plants only have macrotubule and actin. Exactly, good point. So the one intermediate filament is the lamins. And so there is no lamin in plants. But then there's some proteins that probably are doing the same job. There's a whole collection of proteins. So but there is no lamin homologue in the genome. But something else is doing the same thing. Here, I want to point out something that you see maybe somewhat clearly on this drawing, is that, and again, this is a caricature, right? But here you see that the actin is cortical, and the macrotubules are a little bit inside. Actually, I think I have a slide for this coming up. Yeah. So here, I remove all the rest. So you have actin at the cortex. So this is, again, a caricature. So the actin is really very, very important to control cell shapes. in animals. So it's at the cortex a lot with myosin, and this is controlling cell shape, while microtubules are doing most of the vesicle transport. And in plants, it's the opposite. The microtubules are mostly cortical, right below the plasma membrane, and the actin is doing most of the vesicle transport. But as always in biology, it's not 100%, right? So in animals, actin is also contributing to vesicle trafficking, and in plants, microtubules are also contributing to vesicle trafficking. I'm just showing you the dominant trends, right? Okay, but that's actually somewhat important. Because when we look at mechanics, the microtubules are going to be very, very important because they're the ones that are calling to control cell shapes. So how do we do this? How do microtubules control cell shapes in plants? So here you have to imagine that you're inside a cell, inside a plant cell, and you're looking outside, right? You're somewhere in the nucleus and you're looking outside. So what you see here and here, this is the plasma membrane. And what you see, these lines here are the microtubules. And you see they're really like right under the plasma membrane. And they're really cortical. And here there's a little window, so that membrane has been broken during the preparation. And what you see is all these lines here. So that's the cell wall, that's the extracellular matrix. And you see that all these lines actually are cellulose microtubules. And what you see on this image is that this alignment of cellulose, and there is a bias in this direction, is parallel to the microtubule. Actually, there's been a lot of studies that showed this, so I'm just showing it quickly. Microtubules are right below the plasma membrane, and they are like rail tracks for a train, that would be the cellulose synthase, that is synthesizing cellulose outside in the extracellular matrix, in the cell wall. And so when you, you can see it here. So the little green dots, so you have to don't pay attention to this large circulating Golgi apparatus in the background, but if you just look at the small green dots. This is the cellulose synthase, so this is a portion of one cell. You see the green dots traveling here. In the red, that's the microtubules, and you see that the green dots are traveling along the red lines. So it's really like the microtubules are guiding the cellulose synthase, and the cellulose is extruded inside the cell wall, inside the extracellular matrix. And so you see the importance of the microtubules in plants, right? In plant cells, because they're going to control the deposition of cellulose in the cell wall, cellulose being really the stiff element of the cell wall, but they're also going to control the direction of the cellulose orientation in the cell. So for instance, if you have cellulose in this orientation, because the microtubules are like this, that means that this cell is going to be very resistant to stress in this direction, but much less in this direction, right? This is a mechanical anisotropy of the cell wall. You make the cell mechanically anisotropic. So now it resists to stress in this direction, but not in this direction. Right? That's kind of. Yeah? Oh, no, no. This flow here, it's just the Golgi. Huh? So the red, these are the microtubules. So this is one cell, or like a portion of one cell. And these are the microtubules in red, just at the cortex, just below the plasma membrane. So they're just like little filaments right below the plasma membrane. And they're guiding these green dots, this cellulose synthase that is at the plasma membrane. And this, so this is this, huh? That is traveling on the microtubules that are here, right? So it's like a loom, if you want. So it's like constantly synthesizing fibers, of cellulose around the cell. I'll come back to this later on in my talk. So just to give you some information on the importance of microtubules in plants. Okay, so this has consequences on the mechanics of animal and plant cells. Is that when you measure the mechanics of an animal cell, of course this is on average, so this is just the range. You find things in the kilopascal range. So if you, for instance, if you push on an animal cell, that's the type of stiffness you get, which is quite soft, actually. You saw the rubber earlier was in like 7 megapascal range, so this is much less than rubber. Whereas the plant cell is in the megapascal range. It's much, much, much stiffer. Actually, it's 3 order of magnitude stiffer. So this is a very big difference between animals and plants. And actually, you can see a little bit why, right? So here you, yep. Yeah. So I would have to go back to the slide of Denise Disher. But if you go in, actually, it scales to the bones, for instance, that they are the stiffest, and they are like close to the they are in the megapascal range. If you go in the brain, for instance, neurons are one of the softest cells, and it's lower than a kilopascal. That's the range. And the same in plants. Huh? There's also some variation. So what you see, and this is actually an important thing to keep in mind, is that in both cases, you see that you have a cortex of actin here that is kind of stiff a little bit. The extracellular matrix is stiff. But actually, what happens is that here you have also an osmotic pressure in the cell. So you have a balance between this contractile cytoskeleton outside and the osmotic pressure, but it's a very small values, right? The osmotic pressure is very small here. And the cell is resisting to this osmotic pressure with this cytoskeleton, but it's very small values. Whereas here you have a vacuole, so you have a huge osmotic pressure in the megapascal range. And so the cell has to resist to this osmotic pressure with a stiff cell wall. So that's the idea. But we can come back to that here, so it's not completely clear. So that's my last slide. So the idea to and I think Stuart was mentioning this. So the strategy for animal cells is not to have a very stiff extracellular matrix. Is more to have this cortex of actomyosin that is contractile, whereas in plants the strategy is stiffness. It's really based on stiffness. So you have a stiff cell wall. You use the microtubules that are also stiffer than actin. So everything is stiffer in plants. And so that's why Stuart was mentioning that animals have more a liquid type of behavior, whereas plants have a more solid type of behavior. So in terms of mechanics, it's more the mechanic of fluids and mechanic of the solid for plants. Okay, so summary of some definitions. So I told you about complex system, tension, compression, stress, strain, stiffness, growth, plant and animal cell, that's clear, more or less. And the fact that cortical microtubules are guiding the cellulose in cell. And this is going to be, cellulose is really the major mechanical component in plant cells. That's the load-bearing component in plant cells. Okay. So now I'm switching really to the meat. So there's also one difference. There is no dynein in plants. There's only kinesin. For instance, so on the microtubules, but the kinesin can go in both directions.
But the actin-associated ones, all kinds of myosin.
The RP2-free, all this is conserved in plants.
Okay, yeah. And when cell division happens, it's still the microtubules that play the role of the spindle, or?
Spindle is also conserved, but in plants during cell division, I'll talk about this, I think, tomorrow. There are two other microtubule structures that are involved in cell division, but otherwise the spindle is the same. Actually, the spindle is the same, but because there is no dynein, the spindle is less pointy in plants than in animals. And actually, you can. So François Nedelec, for instance, made some models on this. So if you take, if you make a model of a spindle, an animal spindle, so you have this very two triangle, right, of the spindle. If you mutate dynein in this model, then the you have a trapezoid, right? So it doesn't really. It's like a little bit more open. The spindle, and this really looks like a plant spindle.
So some physical things. So the persistence length of these filaments is the same as in animal cells. The microtubules are the
More or less. So I don't have the numbers, but the ratio between actin and microtubules, yes, for sure, it's the same. There are some associated proteins that change the persistence length, notably of microtubules. MAP65, which is a plant one, but the homologous would be ACE1 in animals, is affecting the persistent depth microtubule. So in not exactly the same way, but in the same direction. So it's actually making it softer. Okay, so these are just basic definitions. We can come back to it, but if that's clear enough for everyone, we can move on. So here I'm putting a sentence, all living organisms are pre-stressed. Is this something that, what do you think of this? Is this something completely foreign to you, or do you have some idea about this? No? Okay, so so it's good if you haven't seen it, because I want to make that point, and I think that's really important to understand morphogenesis. And so this actually comes down to Darcy Thompson's book. So I really encourage you to read this book on growth and form by Darcy Thompson. So the centennial was last year, actually. He wrote it in 1917. So of course, in this book, there's a lot of mistakes and everything, right? You can concentrate on the mistakes, but you can also concentrate on the main take-home message, which is the interplay between physics and biology, and how, when you add physics into your biology, you can actually understand things a little bit better. And one of the sentences I'm extracting from this book, which is a famous one, is the form of an object is a diagram of force. What does that mean? Maybe we can just take this room, for instance. So if you take this room, you see the walls are vertical. So they are vertical because we want to separate this room from the rest. We want to keep our air conditioned. We want to have it watertight or whatever. But the walls are vertical because they fight gravity. Right? If I was an architect, I could put like some bending walls, but then it would be much more difficult, right? So if you want to resist gravity, you have to put a vertical wall. So if you look at the shape of this room, you actually also look at the pattern of force. And the vertical wall are giving you the direction of gravity, right? So that's just for this room. So I have another example. So this is a few examples. So this is actually contemporary art, so not from India, but central France, actually. So this is just a pile of stuff. So you can generate any shape with this system. So if you fight gravity, you can generate a lot of shapes like this. And then you can relate here, in this case, is continuous compression through gravity, and you have a shape. So you can relate both shape and the pattern of stress. So maybe something just to give you a little bit of tourism. So into Lyon, so this is a church with the pillars here. And now if you put your physicist lenses and then you see the force, then you see the gravity, right? So these pillars are vertical because they are fighting gravity. Right? So when you see a shape, you also see a pattern of force. Actually, Gaudi used this because all the examples I was showing earlier was continuous compression. You can do the same with continuous tension. So what Gaudi did, so in Spain, in Barcelona, so you put all these threads with little sandbags, and then you tie them all together. So all this is in tension, right, because of gravity. And then what he did is to draw this, right, and then reverse it. And so now you have everything under compression. It's the same equilibrium, right? It's going to resist gravity just in the other direction. You just put an extra minus to the entire tension. Now it's entire compression. And he's used this to build some building. Actually, he hasn't used it for the Sagrada Familia. He's used it for other buildings. Then you have some different shapes of arches that are based on this. But the main message here is that with a pattern of force, you can get a shape, and the shape also related to a pattern of force. Okay, so that doesn't work always in architecture. So this is an example of the earthquake in 1989. So this was a big earthquake. And so in this case, you had to fight gravity, but also some shear stress, right? So some torsion or some movement like this. And so what do you do to react to this or to resist to this? Well, you put pillar in all directions, in as many directions as you can, to resist stress in all directions. So again, you see that in this case, it's a dynamic shape, but you need to resist in all directions. And so you add this pillar. So this is in Berkeley, but in Oakland, it's the same, huh? In San Francisco. Okay, so this is all in buildings. Of course, now it's very tempting to think that maybe it's the same in animals or in living organisms. And so actually, this is really not a new idea. Actually, this is coming from the end of the 19th century. So this is a very, very old idea. So actually, I haven't put his name, but Wolf, it's like the end of 19th century. So if you compare, this is a longitudinal section through a human femur, and you see all these trabeculae inside that are very well organized. And here, so this is from Fritz Kahn. He was making the analogy with the Eiffel Tower, which is, I like the analogy with the Eiffel Tower because this is a building that is completely useless. There is no function for it, really. But the structure has to be maintained. So here, you can really compare something without any bias on function. And so there is this structure. So can we apply the same thing, right? You have a shape, you have a pattern of force. Can we relate the two? And so what Wolf did already in the 19th century was to calculate the pattern of force in a femur. And so here you see the tension, here you see the compression. And so this pattern of force is mainly due to the gravity. So it's your weight on your femur that is inducing this pattern of stress. And you see that actually the bone is building itself to resist mechanical forces, to resist mechanical stress. You see that the trabeculae are aligning along the stress lines. And so this is really an important rule, because everything I'm going to tell you about in my talk can be summarized by this law, is that to live is to survive, in a way. So the cells are constantly resisting mechanical forces, constantly. And they use this, and they use this resistance for many, many functions. Actually, if they were not resisting mechanical stress, they would die, right? They would either explode or implode, but they would not survive. So if you live, if your cell is living, it's actually continuously resisting mechanical stress. Yes? Yeah, same. So it's internal stress. So for instance, I'll take the plant cell example. So you have an osmotic pressure. It's like a little balloon, if you want, that put the envelope under tension. And so the envelope has to resist this trigger pressure, this osmotic pressure. So it has to resist. So even when it's stable. Okay. So, and actually, there's been a lot of modeling since then. And actually, it's quite interesting, because you can apply different type of stress on the bone, and you get different trabeculae architecture. And so from the trabeculae architecture you see inside, you can deduce the position, right? You can you know if that bone was under a vertical stress, let's say, or if you were bent like this, maybe the stress was a little bit different, if you were climbing a tree. And actually, this is used a lot in anthropology, right? That is actually how you can deduce the posture of the animal. If you look at the trabeculae inside, you can deduce the posture, because you know which type of stress was experienced. Okay, so that's for the bone. So all this is great, but the only problem with all these examples is that it's based on gravity, if you think about it, right? Even the femur, it's always gravity. So there's another kind of stress, and I was touching upon it with the osmotic pressure. Another way another cause of stress is actually pre-stress. And so this is the case of the balloon. So if you have a balloon, you have an envelope that is under tension and a gas that is under compression inside, right? So you have something like this. So this is a balance of force in this case. And this is somewhat independent from gravity. You see that the tension in the envelope here is really high, because you have a gas that is putting the envelope under tension in the case of the balloon, but the gravity is probably one or two order magnitudes lower than the tension that you have in the envelope, right? So I don't know how to say that in a different way, but if you put a balloon in the room, of course you can push on it, but the balloon is not going to be more or less inflated if you change the gravity. But if you're in a different planet, maybe it will be a little bit less, but the envelope would still be under tension, right? So the dominant effect, the dominant cause of tension, is the intrinsic tension pattern. Maybe I'll take some other example just to make it maybe a bit clearer. So this is to make a sphere. For instance, if you have a spherical shape, you can get a spherical shape with a pattern of force. So you can relate the shape of a sphere to a pattern of force with this balance of force between tension and compression. If you want to make something flat, one possibility, it's like in the kite. You have a membrane like this with two rods like this. So the two rods are under compression and the membrane is under tension. And this is a stable structure. But there is a force that is there. So it's constantly there. It's pre-stress. That's what it means, huh? Pre-stress or auto-stress. That means there's always mechanical stress in this structure. It's just that it's balanced. So compression and tension are in conflict, but they are they find an equilibrium. And then the shape is stable, right? And so this is actually used a lot in architecture. Notably, this is the case of the suspension bridge. When you want to decrease the amount of material you want to use to build a bridge, this is actually a very economic system, because you, instead of adding more material to resist to gravity, for instance, you now you have an intrinsic balance of stress, which means that you have to use less material. You see, for instance, for the Golden Gate, given the size of the arch, if you had to have a regular bridge, let's say just an arch like this, you would have to use, I don't know how many tons of stone to make it grow like this without breaking, right? So this is, in this case, the threads are under tension, and this is under compression when it's going to be finished. So this is the balance between these two forces that is making the shape. So when you look at the suspension bridge, again, you have a shape, you have a pattern of force, and they are both matching. And there's an additional benefit in addition to the lower cost or the lower amount of material you need, that these structures are extremely robust because they control their intrinsic mechanics, right? They have their own balance in a way. And so this is one of the other, I mean, that's another reason why it's used in architecture and notably in bridges, because these are very resilient, very robust systems. And of course, so so this is a bridge in the wind, actually. Okay, so maybe I should leave this. So why do I say this? And in the beginning, I was saying that living organisms are pre-stressed, because this balance of force actually is present in all living organisms and at all scales. So all cells are pre-stressed. They usually have a membrane that is under tension and a content that is under compression. But this is true also at the supracellular scale, so at the multicellular scale, the tissue level, at the organ scale. So I'm going to give you a few examples. So if you take the intestine, for instance, so I don't know if many of you have already dissected mice, for instance. But if you did, yes, okay, you have a few. So if you dissect a mouse and then you go towards the intestine, it's very springy. You can feel some, it's very elastic in a way. Maybe if you can imagine that when you look at the horror movies, right? It looks very gooey, but also a little more elastic. So in this paper, they try to find if this shape can be related to a pattern of stress and to a pattern of pre-stress. So this is the intestine in a mouse or in a rat. So you have the tube and the mesentery, and it makes this nice shape. And so what they did was to make an analogous model, so not a computational model, but an analogous model. So what you do is that you take a piece of rubber, another piece of rubber, you stretch this one, not the other one, and then you glue the two, and then you relax. And what you obtain is this, is a structure that is circumvoluted like this. And here, you realize that you have a balance between tension and compression in this structure, right? Because you've put this structure under tension. So the other one is going to be under compression, and then they find an equilibrium, and the equilibrium is this circumvoluted shape. And you see that the shape looks a lot like the intestine. So of course, this is not a proof that the intestine is like this, but there is a balance between tension and compression in the intestine. So what they did was the opposite experiment, if you want, is to take the intestine, the gut, and then separate the tube from the mesentery. And what they see is that the tube is extending and that the mesentery is contracting. So that means that the mesentery was under tension before, right? That the tube was under compression. So it's really a balance between tension and compression. And you see here at a pretty large scale. So now I'm switching to plants, finally. So in plants, as I mentioned, is high turgor pressure. So turgor pressure is basically an osmotic pressure. So it's an hydrostatic pressure of osmotic origin. So there's a lot of water coming in the plant, and this is putting the plant, the entire plant under tension, all the surface of the plant under tension. So I put this image because it's in the megapascal range, so that's like what you have in a bike tire. This is really high. Huh? It's 10 times the atmospheric pressure. Really, really high. And so this is the analog model we have for a plant. It's a balloon. And you see here the value of this, because this is a very, very simple mechanical model. It's actually it's one of the simplest mechanical models you can imagine, an envelope under tension and an internal tissue under compression. OK, so how can we say this? I mean, because just saying that there is turgor pressure and the envelope is under tension is a little bit of an overstatement. So there is some experimental support for this. So that's the kitchen experiment. So if you take radishes and you cut radishes, you see that they open a little bit. Huh? They don't open too much, but they open a little bit. The fact that they open means that their envelope is under tension, right? Is this intuitive enough, right? So if you have an envelope under tension, you cut. If there is a gap opening, it means that the envelope was under tension. Same with the rhubarb. So if you peel the rhubarb, and you do all this in water, right? It's not due to dehydration. No? This is really the mechanical equilibrium that you break. So when you peel a rhubarb, the epidermis or the cortex is going to contract. So that means that it was under tension when it was still attached to the rest of the rebound. These are like some intuitive examples to say that indeed the epidermis is under tension, like an envelope of a balloon, if you want. Well, these are other examples. Maybe I can switch, skip this one. So there's some people have done some cuts in tissues, and they see the gap that are opening. So again, that's consistent with the envelope, the epidermis being under tension. There's also some modeling experiments that have tried to. So in this case, what the authors did was to compress plant tissue, and then they were recording the mechanical response. And so, depending on the response, they could discriminate between an aggregate of cells or a shell like this, with an envelope under tension and the tissue under compression. And actually, what you obtain is this. So if you have an aggregate, it's going to be a little bit viscoplastic, right? Whereas here, it's going to be almost purely elastic, right? It's like going like punching on a soccer ball, right? And what you obtain is a response that is like a soccer ball. It's really elastic, and it's consistent with an envelope under tension. So if I leave the mechanics, there are other biological data showing that indeed the epidermis is under tension. It's this actually. So if you make sections in tissues, often you see that the epidermis has a very thick cell wall, and with a lot of components in it. And it's also been measured in with atomic force microscopy, but I don't need to go into this detail. So the cell wall is thicker and stiffer, and this makes sense, right? If the epidermis is under tension, this is where you want to resist to tension. And so this is where you want to have the stiffest elements, right? And so here you have an epidermis that is stiffer. There's even some other examples. So this is like some molecular biology, but very, very simple. So this is a wild-type plant, Arabidopsis. Like that's the usual plant we use, I mean, the most often used plant in the lab. So this is an Arabidopsis. You see, like, it's like about this size, let's say 50, 60 centimeters. And there is this mutant in an hormone pathway, but it doesn't matter, that is dwarf. So when you don't have, when you're not able to sense this hormone, you have a dwarf plant. And what people did was to express, you can just take this one, they express the wild-type gene only in the epidermis of this mutant, and they could restore the growth of the plant. So you have a mutant plant. That is, all the cells are mutants, they cannot respond to this hormone, so the plant should be dwarf. But if you only have the epidermis that is wild type, then you restore completely the shape of the plant. It really shows that the epidermis is really, really important for the growth of the plant. This is really where you have the limiting factor for growth. Of course, I mean, there are other components too. I'm simplifying a little bit, but that's it. So I think the model is not too bad. Okay, so now we have a balloon analogy. So with this, we can calculate a pattern of stress quite easily. So we can use this really with balloon. So this is a quote from Stephen Ray Wright. But so basically, if you have a balloon, you can make balloon of different shapes. And then if you draw like little squares like this, and then you inflate your balloon, you know in which direction the stress is going to be the highest, right? So you can make the experiment with a cylinder. It's not completely intuitive, but makes sense. You can also use math. So I'm not, for sake of time, I'm not going to do it. But if you know that stress is a force divided by an area, you can easily, with the balloon analogy, calculate any stress pattern in a plant tissue. Okay, so that's just the calculus, but I'm not going to go into this. But that's pretty easy. Okay, so I just want to show you this example, so because some recent results we got, so we to really have the local pattern of stress, we use the mutant that is called the Qua1 that has adhesion defects. So in this mutant, you see that the cells are not able to adhere anymore, so they detach naturally. Actually, we see these cracks in the epidermis, which is again evidence that the epidermis is under tension, right? Pull on the cells, if they cannot adhere so well, then they're going to detach. But here we use this property to actually calculate a stress pattern with the balloon analogy, because the rationale is very, very simple. If the cracks is in this direction, that means that the tension was in this direction, right? So all you need to do is to look at the cracks, and from the cracking pattern, you can deduce the stress pattern in the tissue. Right? Is that clear enough? Okay, so Yeah, this is going to be a little bit too long probably, but I'm just going to go a little bit fast. So first we had to check that indeed we can relate this to tension. So here we have a wild-type plant, so it's making normal-looking plants. These are young plants in vitro with a root, a little stem, and the two leaves here. And this is the mutant with the cell adhesion defects, so you see it's pretty sick. And what we do, we use polyethylene glycol, so this is a way to increase the osmolarity of the medium if you want. What you see is that in this case, so when you increase the osmolarity, the turgor pressure is going to decrease, right? It's like you're having more salt, so the water is going to get out of the plant, so it's, the plant is going to grow more slowly. But when there is less tension, then there is less growth, right? There's less pressure from the turgor pressure to grow the plant. But what you see here is that in the mutant, actually, we can restore a wild-type looking plant, like a normal plant. Actually, what happens here is that by reducing tension in the epidermis, actually, we've restored the adhesion defects. And so in a way, it's a mechanical rescue of a genetic mutation, if you want. Because we've reduced the tension, and so now the cracks are less big, and then the plant can live like the wild type. So we have other examples. So this is, for instance, when you, but maybe I can switch this. So this is another example where you play with the agar concentrations, so you also play with the matrix potential, and so you have the same phenotype. So you reduce turgor pressure, you reduce tension, plant is smaller, and you can rescue the mutation just by reducing the tension. You see the power of mechanics here, right? So you can rescue a mutation just by reducing the tension in the tissue. And so that's what you see. So these are the cracks in the epidermis in black. You see that when you increase the agar concentration, so when you reduce the tension, you have almost no more cracks in the epidermis. So now we can use this property to calculate a stress pattern. So this is a leaf, young leaves in qua one, so with all the cracks. We extract the epidermis, we recognize the cracks, and then we deduce the orientation for all the cracks. So now we, sorry? Oh, this is just to recognize different cracks. There's just a color, there's no color code. Huh? Just. Oh, the PI, yeah, sorry. So this is just a leaf that has been stained with oppidum iodide. But that's not too important. It's just so what we can see in the microscope. That's the epidermis. We recognize the cracks and then we quantify. And so now we can test this on different tissues and see the different stress patterns. So this is in the leaf, for instance. And you see that the direction of the cracks are a little bit in all directions. I mean, it's not completely, there's still some distribution, but they are in many directions. So in this case, we have a stress pattern, tension, that is isotropic, right? We pull in all directions, at least in two dominant directions, but in all directions. Yes? Exactly. So you need to look at the emerging cracks. If you wait too long, then indeed it doesn't make sense. Yeah, completely agree. Actually, these ones are a little bit late already. Yeah. So in the leaf, no, but because in this case they are like in all directions. But I'm going to show you where it's almost 100% in one direction. Actually, the two next one. If I take the leaf again, and I look at this time at the junction between the blade and the petiole here, you see that the cracks are usually like this. In this case, we can make the prediction that it's almost always like this, so that means that the tension is like this, right? Maximal tension. And so how can we explain this? And this is actually very, very simple. So the blade here is growing fast and in all directions, whereas the petiole is growing only in this direction. And so what you have here is a mechanical conflict. A local mechanical conflict that is here at the base of the leaf. And so this is actually quite important because, if I don't have time, but maybe I will, in this part of the leaf, there's a lot going on. This is actually where you have the emergence of the growth. The growth rate is controlled a little bit here. There's also some polar proteins that are more polarized in this part. So all this might be related to the mechanical stress pattern. And the last example, which is maybe the most dramatic, is the stem. So this is a wild-type stem. I don't go into detail why it's looking like this, but we have a drug that inhibits organ initiation, so we just have a stem like this. And this is in the mutant, and you see that the cracks are all vertical, like this. So in this case, that means that the tension is like this, right? Like this. So in this case, there is no real differential growth. It is a shallow gradient of growth, but there is no real mechanical conflict. So how can we explain these cracks like this? Do you have any idea why would tension be more like this? Yep, sorry. Yeah, so the Mach-tubules would be one thing, but we don't even need the Mach-tubules. I'm going to show something that might put you on track. So this is a sausage on the barbecue, right? So when you have a sausage on the barbecue, it opens lengthwise. If you haven't put, if you haven't put any holes in the sausage, it opens lengthwise because this is a cylinder. There is pressure that is building up inside, and the envelope is going to be under tension, right? But because it is a cylinder, the tension is going to be twice higher in this direction than in this direction. This is like years of engineering. You can calculate the stress pattern on a balloon. It's exactly the same. So the stress is going to be twice higher in this direction than in this direction. And so this is what we see in the stem. It's really like a cylindrical balloon. There is a bias in the stress pattern that is only determined by shape. So the tissue shape is prescribing the pattern of stress in this case. Okay, and so just to so this was one example in plants. I'm just going to show this slide for the animals. So there's a lot of tools that are developed to measure stress pattern in tissues. I just want to mention this one from OJ Campas. So he's developed these droplets that he can put in tissues, and because they're fluorescent, you can see the deformation of the droplets. And so this is also a nice way to have actually a measure of the internal strain in the tissue and to deduce the stress from strain. I won't say much more about this, but just to show you that you can also deduce stress pattern in animal tissues, and this is one way to do it. Okay, so that's the summary for this part. So you can associate a shape to a pattern of stress, and you can infer a stress pattern using math, modeling, all you want, but you can also show it with experiments. And I've been mentioning this a lot, but the epidermis in plants is under tension. Okay, so now that we have that, we'd like to know what are the targets of this stress. So you can imagine that living tissues are constantly under stress because they are pre-stressed, so they always have this tension-compression balance. So these cells are in this environment where there is tension and compression everywhere. What do they do with it? Or do they use it, or is it completely useless noise? Of course, they use it. This is just the image. So you have shape, mechanical stress pattern, what are doing, what these cells are doing. So here I'm going to take a plant example. So I'm going back to the shoot apical meristem. So this, this is at the tip of the stem. So this is the shoot apical meristem. This is a group of cells that are dividing a lot. And how the cells are dividing, they're ejected away, and they now populate organs that are emerging at the periphery of the meristem. If you want, the shoot apical meristem has two main functions. One is to generate organs. So in this case, it's flowers. And the second one is to self-maintain. It's a little bit like the stem cells. The stem cells of the plants are actually here, right, in the shoot apical meristem. But I'm not going to talk too much about the function of the meristem. For us, it's more like a good morphogenetic system, because there's a lot going on in terms of shape, right? You have this sphere, you have this tissue folding, these different growths. Differential growth, so there's a lot going on. Okay, so I told you earlier that the important mechanical component for the mechanics of plant cells and plant tissues, that's cellulose. So the cellulose is the load-bearing component in plant cells. And cellulose, the cellulose deposition is controlled by Mach-tubules. So the first thing you can do is to remove the Mach-tubules and see what happens. What happens to growth, what happens to shape. So what happens is actually quite spectacular. So this is a young flower. You see like here in the Arabidopsis again. So this is with four sepals here. So if you treat with a drug that removes the Mach-tubule, that depolymerizes the Mach-tubules, then you get this. So you see this flower is bigger already because it's been growing for a while. But you see also that the organs become spherical, right? So this is supposed to be a sepal, which is like almost like a leaf. It should be very flat, elongated. And actually, in this case, it starts as a sphere, basically. And you also see that the cells, they look a little bit like a soap bubble, right? So we've actually looked at this a little bit more closely. Because one of the behavior of soap bubbles when they are in a 2D foam is that they have this curvature property. So when a soap bubble, like a 2D foam like this, has less than six edges, or six walls, let's say, the walls are convex. Whereas if it's more than six, then the walls are concave. And this is due to a pressure difference between the two soap bubbles. So this is in a 2D foam. And when actually we look at our shoot apical meristem in which we remove the microtubules, you see that after a while, the cells with less than six walls, or in 2D, have convex walls, and the one with more than six have concave walls. So we see actually the same geometrical properties in a living tissue, like in soap bubbles, when we remove the microtubules. So what's the take-home message here is that, well, first we can learn a lot from soap bubbles. The second one is that actually what happens when you remove the microtubule is that growth becomes isotropic. So growth, it's the same in all directions, exactly like in soap bubbles. And so this is actually one of the consequences of this growth isotropy, is that the cells are actually really behaving geometrically like soap bubbles. So the cellulose is synthesized really outside of the cell. So the cellulose synthesis is at the plasma membrane and it's synthesizing outside. It's too steep inside the cell, actually. It would break everything.
So. Olivia, like in animal epidermal tissues, these don't undergo topological transitions like T1?
So the plant cells are glued to one another. So there is no intercalation. This vertex is going to be there till the death of the plant. It's not going to move. Okay, so the microtubules are very important for the growth isotropy, but actually when you remove the microtubules, so this is a longitudinal section through the shoot apical meristem, you see that actually there's a lot of morphogenetic events that are impacted. And one of them is tissue folding. What you see here is an organ, this is the meristem, you see a fold here, and actually when you remove the microtubules, actually the tissue is unfolding. So instead of folding even more and then separating the organ from the meristem, actually what happens is that it unfolds. You lose this separation. You see that here we see indeed that this microtubule, this cellulose is really important for morphogenesis. So this is just a movie to show you actually the microtubule. So they, I'm not sure you can see very well, but the microtubules are aligned here, and this is where the tissue is folding. So there's a good match between the position where the microtubules are aligned and the tissue where the tissue is folding. And here again, an image of the meristem after microtubule depolarization, and you see that there is no folding at all here. This is the organ, this is the meristem, and you can guess that it's almost flat here. Whereas here it's really folded. Maybe I'll skip this. Where I need to point. this is, you see again, the alignment of microtubules where the tissue is folding, the meristem, the organ here, and you see this alignment of microtubules, and also here, the stable alignment of microtubules here, whereas here the microtubules keep changing their orientation. So there is this pattern of microtubules, and here we can, what we can say from here is that the cellulose is probably very well oriented here and less oriented here, right? Same here, it's less oriented and very well oriented here. Where I need to point. Okay, so. Going back to meristem, so we have this local bumps here where there is more outgrowth. And what we propose is that the microtubules and the cellulose actually are stiffening this region, and this is what is helping to fold. Right? That's what I showed with you with the microtubule depolarization, microtubule alignment. So apparently, this is what is controlling tissue folding in this case. What's the relation with mechanical stress in all this? So if I go back to this image of the microtubule in the meristem, you see this alignment of microtubules here between the organ, so this is an organ, this is the meristem, the alignment, another organ. And now we are going to calculate the pattern of stress on this tissue. So now if we use the balloon analogy, the one I showed you earlier, so now we have an envelope that is under tension, we can calculate the stress pattern based on the shape, and what we find is this. At the top of the meristem, you have almost like a half sphere, so the pattern of stress is isotropic, it's the same stress in all directions. The stem, it's a cylinder, so the tension is going to be twice higher in this direction than in this direction, right? It's the sausage on the barbecue analogy, right? So you have more tension in this direction. And in the boundary, in this region where the microtubules are so well aligned, actually you have an organ here that is growing fast, that is pushing on the meristem. And this is also the base of a cylinder, if you want, or here also is another cylinder. So here, actually, the tension is really directional. There's a high anisotropic tensile stress here. Lots of tension in this direction. And what you see on this map of predicted stress, that there is a good match between the stress pattern and the microtubule orientation. And that's really the main take-home message, is that you calculate the stress pattern, you look at the microtubules, and there is almost a perfect match between the pattern of stress and the pattern of microtubules. So all you need to, so if you want to show that in time, so if you have a sphere in the beginning, let's say you have microtubules in all directions, so we have cells like this actually in plants, where you remove the cell wall and then you have a sphere and the microtubules are in all directions. All you need is some stochastic effect or some local heterogeneity, like for instance, if it's not exactly a sphere, if it's a little ellipse like this, like a little bit elongated, then that's it. The minute you switch from the sphere to something a little bit elongated, the tension is going to be higher in this direction. Then the microtubules are going to align like this, and then the cell is going to elongate. Because you're going to reinforce the cellulose in this direction, and then the cell is going to elongate in this direction. So it can be stochastic, or often actually it can be the neighboring cells too, right? So if you have only one cell, it can stay a sphere forever, right? But if you have, there's always a neighboring cell that is dividing, for instance, so you have a new vertex, and so this is a local heterogeneity, and this is enough to affect the stress pattern. So of course, there are other signals too, huh? But if you only consider mechanical forces, that could be... Yeah, exactly. So to modulate this, usually what plants are doing, they are modulating their cell wall properties. So either you make the cell wall stiffer or softer, and so you're going to grow faster or slower. So if you have a soft cell wall, you're going to grow faster because then the wall is not going to resist so much, and the cell is going to expand very quickly. If you want the cell to grow slowly, you want a stiff cell wall to resist, and then you're going to grow more slowly. So that's only the growth rate. If you want to change the growth direction, this is through the cellulose. It's by playing with the mechanical anisotropy of the cell wall. So if you have these hoops of cellulose in one direction, then you're going to induce growth in this direction, but not in. Yeah, exactly. So if you play with the mechanical properties of the envelope of the balloon, you can generate any shape. Actually, the alphabet of growth, so in plants, the motor of growth is sugar pressure. That's really what put the wall under tension. And then you modulate the wall, either the anisotropy or the stiffness, the mechanical properties of the wall, then you can change growth direction and growth rate. And this is enough, so it's very, very simple. Huh? We only have two parameters, sugar pressure and cell wall properties, and in the cell wall we have two sub-parameters that are the direction and the rate in growth, and that's it. With this we can explain any shape. It's a very powerful system, plants, for the mechanics, because the mechanics is very, very simple. There is no contractility. It's only stiffness, and it's the mechanics of the solid. So it's much, much simpler. I'm going to show you, you're going fast already, but given the time, actually, it's good. So I can go a little bit faster. But indeed, this is a feedback loop.
Oh, one last, maybe you answered this. The motors don't do anything here?
They're not too involved, actually. You mean like the kinesin?
Yeah.
I mean, they are involved in cellulosynthesis, but their contribution to this feedback loop is very small.
Then why do the microtubules show patterns? Why do they align? I mean, is it just steric?
I don't know if I tell you this now or later, but maybe I can tell you now. So if you grow a microtubule in vitro, if you put this microtubule under tension, you're going to promote polymerization. If you put them under compression, you're going to promote depolymerization. So the microtubules alone are sensitive to tension. And so if you imagine that you have a population of microtubules that are bundling with one another, that are self-organizing in a way, in a parallel arrays, if you put that 2D surface with microtubule under tension, in the end, you're going to have microtubules aligning with tension, because tension is promoting polymerization and compression with the promoter. So it could very well be really a multi-scale property of the microtubules. The microtubules themselves are responding to tension, and in the end, you have a plant shape. To put it very, it's a multi-scale thing. Okay, so just because you were apparently all convinced that tension controls the microtubules, so we've done a few experiments still to make sure that this is true, because this is just a correlation at this point. And I just mentioned this because this is really workflow in plants, right? So it's the exoskeleton of the plant cell that is reinforced in the direction of maximal stress, right? So it's exactly like in the bone, but at the cellular level, and it's the extracellular matrix, but it's exactly the same idea. You resist maximal stress. But that's the hypothesis. So we've done a few things. So one of them was to first make a model to show this. So you can do different type of models, but this is sort of an old model now, but it still works. So you can make you can represent each wall in 2D as springs. So we consider that they're only elastic. You have these springs, and now in this mass spring network of cells, you can apply Hooke's law. Just have this term that's just to add some viscosity, it's just in the model so that it doesn't look like a real spring and it oscillates, right? So to remove the oscillation just to show something more, a bit more like a growing cell. But this is not changing the mechanics too much. So that would be Hooke's law. You have springs and you put a feedback on K, the stiffness, depending on the orientation of the microtubules, right? So if, for instance, in this cell, if the microtubules are in this orientation, this is going to be very stiff. This is going to be soft, right? The spring that is perpendicular to the microtubule is also going to be perpendicular to the cell, to the cellulose on the top wall here. And so this is going to be very stiff. If the cellulose is like this, the cell is... that's the opposite. So if the microtubules are like this, this is going to be very soft. The cell is going to be able to expand like this. But this one, this wall here, this spring is going to be, it's going to be difficult to extend it because the cellulose in this direction. Right? Anyway, so in the model, we can play with K to have the impact of cellulose on the stiffness of the spring. And so what we see when we do that, so we have every cell expressing this algorithm, right? So that's really a complex system. So each cell is has this rule, but it needs to orient its cellulose, its microtubule, with maximal tension. And what happens when you take a real template like this, you show the shape like this, you put this under tension, and what happens is that the microtubules that are represented by this red line are aligning like this, and there is a supracellular alignment here that is emerging from the local response of each cell to mechanical stress. So you can have a supracellular response that is emerging from a local response to tension. So this is, again, only a correlation. So if you really want to go closer to causality, you need to change the stress pattern and to see if the microtubules are going to change their orientation as well, right? So if you change the stress pattern, would the microtubules change their behavior as well? So you can do this in different ways, but the simplest one is probably the ablation. So this is again, so in this case, this is a finite element model. So this is in 3D. So instead of having several springs, you have elastic triangles, if you want, that are all connected to one another, and you put all this under tension. And so this allows you to make 3D mechanical models. So this is the epidermis, and the red lines are the stress patterns, so it's a little bit, let's say, random in the beginning. And then you kill one cell, so you remove the top wall. All this is under tension. And what happens is that the stress is predicted to become circumferential. So when you kill one cell, the tension is going to be like this, when the epidermis is under tension. That's with this assumption. So just to have a little movie to show that, so that's what happens when you shoot into a soap bubble or a big bubble. You see that there is a small hole and the hole is getting bigger and bigger. So if you don't want the hole to get bigger and bigger, you need to reinforce here, right? So circumferentially around the impact. And so this is giving you also the stress pattern, right? Okay, so that's the prediction from the model or this analog model also. And so when we do the experiment, so this is the microtubule, this is cell shape, this is the merge signal, this is before ablation. So then we use a pulse QV laser, so we kill one or two cells here. And then we look at the microtubules, and it takes a while, but in the end, they become circumferential, right? So they've realigned with the tension. Of course, the ablation is not the best experiment because it also induces a lot of chemical stuff. So you need to do other tests. So that's what we did, but I'm not going to bore you with the list of, but it all works. I mean, they all work. So if you compress, if you do, if you change the stress in different ways, you always see the microtubule aligning with maximal tension. Yeah, exactly. So in stomata, so actually we haven't published this, but so what happened in stomata is that these are two cells, two guard cells that are opening and closing all the time. So they sort of mechanically they change, and so they pull or push on the neighboring cells. And so what we see is that around stomata, the microtubules are circumferential. And actually what we think is happening is actually a little bit more complex, is that when the stomata is closing, what happens is that the stomata is actually moving up. So you have a little hill. So it's pulling, making a little hill, and because of that, the stress is becoming circumferential also. It's a bit more complex than the ablation, but the answer is the same. So in this picture, you see the microtubules guiding the cellulose synthase, the cellulose. What we added is this, basically, so tension. So all this is aligned. Microtubule, cellulose in the extracellular matrix, and tension, all this has the same orientation. So you would think that this is a pretty minor thing, right? We just added another ingredient in the mix. But actually, it's quite important because this is the feedback loop that someone mentioned earlier. That is really important to understand plant morphogenesis. When you have microtubule orientation, you can predict the cellulose deposition, and so you can predict the growth direction, right? So it's, you reinforce with the hoops like this, so you're going to promote the growth in this direction. This is going to control shape and multicellular shape, and notably here, you saw the alignment of microtubules here that is involved in the folding of the tissue. It's like a gastrulation in plants, if you want, like an invagination, but with cell wall and all this, but it's the same idea, right? It's tissue folding. So you can generate a shape, but the shape itself is prescribing a pattern of stress. So the shape is also a cue. And in this case, we saw that for the shoot apical meristem, depending on where you are, you have a positional information that is mechanical in nature. And that can actually, well, have different properties in different regions, but here what we saw is that it's actually orienting the microtubules. And so you see that this feedback loop is locking the system in an infernal loop, if you want. Because once you've started to be here, there's no way out, right? The microtubules always have to resist to stress. By doing this, they're going to change the shape. But when they change the shape, they're going to affect the pattern of stress. And so this goes on like this. So actually, the best example for this is why are stem cylindrical? And this is actually it's actually very simple. So if you take a cylinder, so that would be the stem. So we saw that the tension is like this, right? Maximal tension is like this. So there's a little bit of tension like this, actually. So that's the pattern of stress. So now the microtubules and the cellulose is going to be like this, right? Resisting maximal tension. So by doing this, they're going to reduce the tension here, right? They're going to resist the tension. But by doing this, this tension is not resisted for. So now you have tension here. And so this is what explains that you have growth in this direction, right? But when you grow in this direction, you maintain the cylindrical shape. And so you maintain the stress pattern in the end, right? You still have maximal tension in this direction. So in a way, a cell that is in a cylinder is trapped into a cylinder for the rest of its life, unless some overcue from the outside, like a hormone, something that is softening the cell wall suddenly, or that is destroying the microtubule or something, is going to change this. But if nothing else happens, the cylinder is going to stay a cylinder always. So just to not stay only in plants, there are homologous situations in animals. But as I told you, in animals, the cortex of the cell and what controls cell shape is more the actin, actomyosin. And actually, biology is well done. It's really analogous in animals, but with actin and myosin. So this is in Drosophila. So depending on where you are in the Drosophila embryo, the pattern of stress is going to be different. This is going to depend, actually, in this case, mostly on growth and like cell movement. But when you have tension in this case, yep, that's my cue. So the actin is going to align with maximal tension. And here, if it's isotropic, you see that you have these rings of actin. And so this is going to impact shape in the end. But if you impact shape, in turn, you're going to affect the stress pattern. This is really well studied in animals, but you see really the analogy with what I showed you, or the homology with what I showed you in plants, right? It's really the same idea. Here, you control the contractility of the animal cell with the actomyosin cytoskeleton, but there's also this feedback with shape and growth on the stress pattern and then on the cytoskeleton. Okay, so given the time, I'm just going to stop here. So the summary, so yep, the microtubules are guiding the cellulose. and in the cell wall, they align with maximal tensile stress, and this is a mechanical feedback loop that is controlling plant morphogenesis, and you have comparable feedback in animals. And also, yeah, of course, absolutely. There's also actually in bacteria, it's very interesting. The peptidoglycan is also making this oops like this in cylindrical cells. Absolutely. All right, so I had something else after that, but I'm going to stop here to allow more questions. Thank you. Okay, there's no more questions.
If there are no more questions, yeah. Thank you, Olivia, for your wonderful talk. We shall break for tea.